60th anniversary of Victory's Dive Bed, and that was a conference in Volgograd. And I remember that the main speaker at that conference was a colleague of General Gergiev's, Marshal Yazov. And I was accompanied on that trip to Volgograd, in fact, by today's chair, Professor Mirkov. And I also remember there was a big campaign going on at the time to change the name of Volgograd to Stalingrad. I noted that some progress has now been made and spent by the decision to change the name to Stalingrad on a certain number of days every year. Okay, going back to the Second World War, this gripped the Western imagination as much as the Battle of Stalingrad. The progress of the battle was widely reported in the Western Allied press at the time, and public opinion was clear that this was the decisive moment. When the battle was over, the Soviet victory at Stalingrad was hailed as the salvation of Western civilization, and as the beginning of the end for Hitler and the Nazi regime. In an editorial on the battle published on the 4th of February 1943, the New York Times wrote as follows: Stalingrad is the scene of the costliest and most stubborn struggle in this war. In the scale of its intensity, its destructiveness, and its horror, Stalingrad has no parallel. It has engaged the full strength of the two biggest armies in Europe and could fit into no less a framework than that of a life and death conflict which encompasses Europe. In the last 70 years, Stalingrad has continued to occupy a central place in Western historical consciousness about the Second World War. The fighting in the city of Stalingrad, the surrender of Kalas and the Sixth Army, and the great Soviet counteroffensive of November 1942, these are among the most iconic images of the Second World War. Russian historians sometimes complain that the decisive Soviet role in the defeat of Nazi Germany is not given enough credit in the West, and that the great battles of Soviet Germany were neglected by Western historians. There is some truth in this accusation. There is, in fact, quite a lot of coverage of the Soviet German War in the West, both by historians and in the media. At the centre of this historical attention has always been Stalingrad. This fascination with Stalingrad in the West has been fed by a constant stream of histories, novels, films, and documents. Very important has been the publication and translation of German and Soviet memoirs of the West, particularly the memoirs of Marshal Vasily Chirkov. It's Chirkov's memoirs, his treatment of the battle, that forms the basis for most Western accounts of Stalingrad. Post-war Western historiography of the battle begins with the publication in 1946 of Alexander Wolff's book, The Year of Stalingrad. Wolff was a Western correspondent in Moscow during the war, and his book combined memoir and personal observation together with a close reading of Soviet sources. Wolff repeated his treatment of Stalingrad in his General History of the Soviet German War, Russia at War, published in 1964. There were a number of German books on Stalingrad published in the 1950s, but there was no English follow-up to Wolff's book until Ronald Seth published his book on Stalingrad in 1959. Seth knew Russian and had visited the city and interviewed Soviet participants in the battle. Seth, like Alexander Wolff, it was clear that the Soviet victory of Stalingrad was the turning point of the tide of the war against Hitler, not just for the Soviet Union, but for all the members of the Allied coalition. The second Wolff view of the importance of the Stalingrad turning point is nowadays a commonplace view in the West. But that was not the case in the 1950s. The outbreak of the Cold War meant that it was politically convenient to underplay the decisive Soviet role in defeating Nazi Germany, and to forget the colossal losses of the Red Army and the Soviet people. During the Second World War, Winston Churchill had said, and I quote, "The guts of the German army have been largely torn out by Russian valour and generalship." But Churchill also claimed that the Allied invasion of North Africa and Rommel's defeat at El Alamein in October 1942 was as important as Operation Uranus and the Red Army's encirclement of the Germans at was this thing that predominated in Churchill's influential multi-volume history of the Second World War, published in the late 40s and early 1950s. According to Churchill, what he called the hinge of fate of the war in 1942, that hinge of fate revolved around El Alamein and not just Iran. In the 1960s and 1970s, the Western historiography about the Stalingrad developed considerably. There were a number of books about Stalingrad, specifically, and extensive treatments of the battle in general works by Western historians on the Soviet German War. In terms of the popular history of the war, the most important and influential book was William Craig's Enemy at the Gates, published in 1973. Like much Western literature on Stalingrad, Craig's book was based mainly on German sources. And his treatment was quite balanced, and he captured the drama of the battle very effectively. And he detailed the enormous casualties incurred by the Red Army in defending the city. And I remember when I first read that book, I just couldn't believe the scale of the Soviet casualties at Stalingrad. Craig's book, in particular his story about famous Soviet sniper at Stalingrad, Valery Zaitsev, that book was the basis for the film Enemy at the Gates, released in 2001. But that film actually gives a rather distorted impression of Craig's book. Craig's book actually avoided the typical Western stereotypes the Soviet system has depicted in the film. Stereotypes of a war dominated by brutal generals and crazy commissars shooting their own soldiers. Many different views were expressed in Western literature on Stalingrad, but there were some common themes and arguments. Firstly, the Stalingrad was a Soviet victory as well as a German defeat, i.e. there was recognition of the merits of the Soviet political and military leaders, including Stalin, of the utility of the Soviet communist system in mobilizing the country's resources, and of the critical role played by the patriotic mobilization of the Soviet people winning the battle and the war. Secondly, that the Soviet victory at Stalingrad owed much to the heroic defence of the city by its Red Army defenders. In this respect, Western commentary was heavily influenced by the Soviet heroic literature about the battle, including the accounts by Soviet writers such as Simonov, Grossman, and Nekrasov. Thirdly, that Stalingrad was the most important battle and the most decisive victory of the Second World War. Of course, that particular argument about Stalingrad is a contested one, as of course it is in Russia, and there are those that would argue that Moscow is cursed, at least as important as Stalin. But most people would say that Stalingrad was the key battle. In the 1990s, that's to say, after the collapse of communism and the fall of the Soviet Union, another trend in Western treatments of Stalingrad began to gain some prominence. And this was the perspective that categorised the battle as merely an episode in the barbaric struggle between Nazi and Soviet totalitarianism. The Soviet Union triumphed at Stalingrad, it was argued, only because of the brutality of the communist system and the horrors enforced on Red Army soldiers by the Soviet authorities. A key text in this strand of Western historiography was Anthony Beaver's book on Stalingrad, published in 1998, a book that has been read by millions of people throughout the world in many different languages and in Russian as well. Now, Beaver did not know Russian, but he was able to employ some researchers to work in the newly opened Soviet archives. And the material that they supplied to him, he used to detail the harsh discipline enforced on Soviet soldiers at Stalingrad, including a large number of executions that were carried out to ensure the discipline. But reading Beaver's book, it was difficult to understand why, if the Soviets were so brutal to World War's own people, difficult to understand if that was the case, why the Germans didn't win the battle rather than the Red Army. In truth, brutality and martial discipline, which there was undoubtedly quite a lot of Stalingrad, is not a sufficient explanation as to why the Red Army was able to hold on in Stalingrad. The problem with Beaver's book was its insufficient recognition that a prolonged, intense and costly battle such as Stalingrad could never have been won without the heroism and voluntary sacrifice of the great majority of the Red Army forces. That was the argument in my own book on the battle, Victory at Stalingrad, The Battle that Changed History, which was published in 2002, also subsequently published in Russia. My aim in that book was to retell in a popular and accessible form the epic story of Stalingrad, to correct the mistaken impressions created by Aviv and others, and to interrogate Soviet, German, and Western accounts of the Battle of Stalingrad. And, most important of all, to reassert the historical significance of the Soviet victory. My book was followed by the publication in 2007 of a very important Western book on Stalingrad by a historian called Michael Jones. His book, called Stalingrad, How the Red Army Triumphed. And Jones' book is based mainly on the testimony of Soviet veterans of the battle. Through the accounts of these Soviet witnesses, Jones showed that the Red Army triumphed at Stalingrad because something quite extraordinary happened there during the course of the battle. At Stalingrad, the Red Army was transformed into an army of mass heroism. Heroism was the rule rather than the exception at Stalingrad. And this heroism was present at every level of the Red Army, from the private to the general. Now, Jones's narrative, of course, is based on the testimony of the veterans, is possibly a little exaggerated and over-romanticized, but he constructs a powerful case for the myth of heroic Stalingrad, a myth that, of course, was created by the Soviet authorities during the war, during the battle itself, that myth was actually based on reality. I would add to Jones's argument that the heroism displayed by the Red Army in Stalingrad was nothing new. It had many, many precedents. There was an established tradition of Red Army heroism, mass heroism, even before, way before, long before Stalingrad. And I'm thinking here of the defense of the Brest fortress in June 1944. Of the battles on the approaches to Lenin, of the defense of Tula and the defense of Moscow, and of course of the siege of Sebastopol in 1941-1942. Jones's book was also important because he proposed a number of revisions to the standard Western accounts of the course of the battle itself. These accounts having been heavily influenced by Chuikov's memoirs. For example, Jones contests Chuikov's claim that he never contemplated evacuating his headquarters to the eastern bank of the Volga. So Jones cites documentary evidence that actually Chuikov made the request to be evacuated, but he was overruled by the higher ruler. But on the whole, Jones's portrait of Chuikov is a very positive one, and Chuikov emerges as a tough but heroic general who shared the privations and dangers. Another important point made by Jones is that while the Soviets did impose harsh discipline at Stalingrad, the number of ex-soldiers they executed was relatively small. The vast majority of the soldiers caught fleeing the battlefield were simply returned to their units. Indeed, the so-called blocking detachments who were carrying out this duty of retaining soldiers and sending them back to their units, and sometimes carrying out executions, those very same blocking detachments also fought in the battle at Stalingrad. Indeed, fought as heroically as the Red Army comrades. At Stalingrad, even the NKVD was horrific. In terms of the detailed operational history of the Stalingrad campaign and the battle, the most important recent work has been books by the American military historian David Blaine and his co-author Jonathan House. And these two authors have published the first two volumes of a massive trilogy on Stalingrad that has already become the standard Western work on the battle in terms of detailed operational history. David Blatz, of course, I'm sure he's a name very well known here, is the author of many books about the Soviet-German War. The most controversial of his books, and I know that this is a topic that has interested Professor Graham over the years, the most controversial of Blatz's books is, of course, his book called Zhukov's Greatest Defeat, The Red Army's Epic Defeat in Operation Mars. Mars, of course, was the companion operation to Operation Uranus. It was an attack on Army Group Center in the Rzhev-Vyazma area as it is, there's not been very little for it to show for. Blatt argues that for Zhukov, Mars was more important than Uranus, and that he spent more time on preparations and supervision of Mars than he did on Uranus, and Uranus being left largely to Vasilevsky to organize. This particular controversy I examined again in my recent book, my recent biography of Zhukov, where I pointed out that actually Operation Mars was the third in a series of failed operations in the Rzhev Vyazma area. And that's an insight gained from reading the work of Russian military historians, especially the historian Svetlana Gerasimova. I also argued in my book that while in his memoirs Zhukov might have over-dramatized his role in relation to Operation Uranus and ignored the failure of Mars, the same Russia success as many fathers, but failure is always an awful. And Zhukov was always keen to talk up his victories and to downplay his failures. That, irrespective of the failure of Mars, there's no doubt that he and Vasilevsky, Zhukov and Vasilevsky, were the two main architects of the Soviet victory of the Stalin. The series of 70th anniversaries of the Second World War began in 2009. I've seen the publication of a number of new Western histories, general histories of the war, including one just recently by Anthony Lincoln, a book that actually opens with an account of Zhukov's famous victory at Halkin Gol in August 1949. Of course, if you want to read the real story about Halkin Gol, then you need to read my own book about Zhukov. These new Western books, including Beam's latest effort, these new Western books about the Second World War share a bias towards the Western role in the war that has historically been displayed in Western accounts of the Second World War. But this new literature also reflects greater recognition of the centrality of the Soviet-German conflict, and in particular the importance of Stalin as the great turning point of the war. Winston Churchill famously said, I quote, he said, "Before El Alamein, we haven't never had a victory. After El Alamein, we never had a defeat." And he also talked, as you may know, about El Alamein being at the end of the beginning. Actually, the end for Nazi Germany began at Stalingrad. And without that Soviet victory, without the Soviet victory at Stalingrad, Britain would have faced many more defeats at the hands